with the recent announcement that Warner Brothers would be releasing their entire slate on HBO Max, we thought it might be fun to talk about one of the movies in question, in particular about Kong vs. Godzilla, and, in particular, about Kong Skull Island. Cinematographer Larry Fong has discussed Kong Skull Island as a mashup between Apocalypse Now, The Thin Red Line, and Bong Joon-ho's monster movie The Host. This unique combination accounts for a lot of what makes Jordan Vogt Roberts' 2017 creature feature such an unexpected delight. Skull Island is the highlight to date of the so-called Monsterverse, the reimagining of classic gigantic monsters produced by Legendary Entertainment and Warner Brothers. The studios have struggled somewhat with the other films in the series. While there are aspects to recommend either film, both 2014's Godzilla and 2019's Godzilla King of the Monsters suffer greatly in comparison not only to Vogt Roberts' Skull Island, but also to Hideki Anno's Shin Godzilla from 2016. There are multiple reasons why such comparisons fail to flatter Godzilla and King of the Monsters. However, the most immediate point of distinction is that Godzilla and King of the Monsters struggle to be about anything in any meaningful sense. Godzilla might be read as a metaphor for the reaction to trauma, both personal and cultural, but it fails to hammer that theme. King of the Monsters gestures broadly at the idea of environmental apocalypse, but with no more nuance than something like, oh, I don't know, The Man with the Golden Gun, in which Christopher Lee has a giant solar-powered laser.
Now that's what I call solar power.
Both Skull Island and Shin Godzilla have a much deeper understanding of what their monsters are actually saying. Anno constructed Shin Godzilla not only as a commentary on the horrific Fukushima nuclear disaster, but also on the ways in which bureaucracy ultimately suffocates those it is meant to protect. Screenwriters Dan Gilroy, Max Borenstein, and Derek Conley position Skull Island as a commentary on war and its place in human nature. This is an interesting approach to take to King Kong. Throughout Skull Island, Vogt Roberts seems to be drawing rather heavily from the iconography and themes most closely associated with classic Godzilla movies. This is obvious, for example, in the opening credits, which focus on the development of advanced weaponry following the Second World War, including the development and deployment of the hydrogen bomb. Historically, the testing of the hydrogen bomb has been more closely tied to Godzilla than to King Kong. After all, King Kong predates both the atomic and the hydrogen bombs, dating back to the 1930s. In terms of Godzilla, the metaphor of the bomb was filtered through a uniquely Japanese perspective. The original 1954 Gojira drew heavily from the story of Lucky Dragon No. 5, the Japanese fishing boat caught in the weapon tests at Bikini Atoll. The inevitable American adaptation of the monster tend to erase the anti-war subtext. Notably, it was stripped out of the American release of the original 1954 film. More recently, both 2014's Godzilla and King of the Monsters ultimately find the creature fighting alongside the US military. As such, there is perhaps something to be said for the decision to retrofit these anti-war themes to King Kong, perhaps the quintessential giant American monster. In doing so, Skull Island more carefully positions the gigantic ape as a counterpart to Godzilla, approaching some of the same ideas from a different vantage point. Vogt Roberts offers a collision of war movie and monster movie, which manages to offer surprisingly deep meditation on the very idea of war. Skull Island is set against the backdrop of the end of the Vietnam War. Early in the film, a television shows Richard Nixon delivering his promise of peace with honor.
We have concluded an agreement to end the war and bring peace with honor in Vietnam.
This peace is not treated as good news for some of the major characters. Lieutenant Colonel Preston Packard does not seem happy at the prospect of returning home after the loss of the Vietnam War.
We didn't lose the war. We abandoned it.
More cynically, monster expert Bill Randa races to get the government to sign off his expedition while the spending is still good. After all, war is good for business. Houston Brooks is only able to convince Senator Al Willis to fund the expedition by appealing to Cold War anxieties and stating the fear that the Russians might get there first.
Whatever's there, you want us to find it first.
That almost makes sense.
Skull Island is steeped in imagery and sounds associated with Vietnam. Early on, soldiers sit around listening to Time Has Come Today, which had been featured heavily in the Vietnam movie Casualties of War and in the first episode of the History Channel's Vietnam in HD. More recently, the song was used in Spike Lee's The Five Bloods, cementing its association with the conflict. Later on, the film features Bad Moon Rising, which was famously an anthem for US troops in Vietnam. Skull Island offers other visual allusions to the conflict. Late in the film, the characters navigate a burial site decorated by the bones of Kong's parents. However, it evokes more than just the death of monsters.
I've taken enough photos of mass graves to recognize one.
This walk through a graveyard devolves into chaos during a monster attack, with the use of brightly saturated green smoke and gas masks, recalling photos of Agent Orange being dumped on local populations. Vogt Roberts draws most overtly from Francis Ford Coppola's epic Apocalypse Now. Cinematographer Larry Fong lights Skull Island in strong colours. And editor Richard Pearson cuts the movie together like a music video, evoking something of the trippy and hallucinatory quality of Coppola's war film. At points, Vogt Roberts seems to lift shots directly, whether sequences of helicopters bombing the jungle, or the bold yellow and orange imagery of the character's first encounter with the majestic Kong. You know, I'd go so far as to call it Apocalypse Now, except War of the Planet of the Apes got there a little bit earlier than I did. There's probably something in the fact that several ape-themed war movies of the 2010s happened to emulate Apocalypse Now so thoroughly and completely, but that's probably a discussion for another time. That said, I guess you could say that the enemy in Skull Island is the Viet Cong. I regret nothing. Apocalypse Now is an interesting touchstone even beyond the Vietnam setting. Although set against the backdrop of Vietnam, Apocalypse Now often seems more engaged with the abstract idea of war than the specifics of this war in particular. This mythic framework is suggested in an early conversation with General Corman.
There's a conflict in every human heart, between the rational and the irrational, between good and evil. And good does not always triumph.
In hindsight, it makes almost perfect sense that director George Lucas originally wanted to make Apocalypse Now, and that when Francis Ford Coppola took over, Lucas would go on to produce Star Wars instead. The two are almost warped mirrors of one another. Both Apocalypse Now and Star Wars are meditations on the light and dark in the human heart. Of course, Apocalypse Now is a much more cynical text, suggesting that good and evil are not always so clearly delineated from one another. Apocalypse Now was set in Vietnam, but its timelessness is underscored by the fact that it was adapted from Joseph Conrad's 1899 novella, Heart of Darkness. Vogt Roberts makes a rather overt reference to the novella by naming Tom Hiddleston's protagonist, James Conrad. In Apocalypse Now, as Captain Benjamin L. Willard ventures further upriver and deeper in country, he's confronted with a variety of surreal and uncanny imagery. The monsters that appear in Skull Island are only marginally weirder than Willard's journey into some abstract and primal past. Both Skull Island and Apocalypse Now suggest that war is not something confined to a physical space or a material time, but is instead something that stirs in a more primal sense. In Skull Island, that timelessness is suggested from the outside. The opening scene plays as a riff on Hell in the Pacific, with an American soldier and a Japanese soldier trapped together on an island during the Second World War, becoming unlikely allies and later friends. Years later, when Hank Marlow encounters new arrivals, he is not surprised to discover that war has continued in his absence.
Hey, what happened with the war? Did we win?
Which one?
That makes sense.
Early in Apocalypse Now, Willard suggests the Vietnam War is inside of him.
Every time I think I'm gonna wake up back in the jungle. When I was home after my first tour, it was worse. I'd wake up and there'd be nothing.
Willard brings the war to his upmarket Saigon hotel room, tearing it apart with his bare hands. In Skull Island, reflecting on his father's history as a soldier, Conrad muses,
I suppose no man comes home from war. Not really.
However, Skull Island suggests that this idea of war is a strictly human concern. It does not originate in nature. Separated from the group, Colonel Jack Chapman has a few close encounters with giant monsters, like Kong or a stick insect. In both cases, the creature seems to be largely oblivious to his presence. When Packard promises his men that this is one war we are not going to lose, it is clear that he has manufactured a conflict with Kong merely to satisfy the violence within himself. Many of the creatures in Skull Island are oblivious to soldiers until they provoke a response.
You don't go into someone's house and start dropping bombs unless you're picking a fight.
This is not just metaphorical. At one point, Captain Earl Cole explains that he carries an AK-47 that he confiscated from a Vietnamese farmer, as a reminder that
sometimes an enemy doesn't exist until you're looking for one.
This is what makes Skull Island so interesting. This rather more cynical and jaded portrayal of the United States military provides a sharp contrast with the gung-ho patriotism of both Godzilla and King of the Monsters. However, while it fits thematically with the anti-war messaging of the classic Japanese monster movies like Godzilla, it realigns that core theme to reflect the American experience of that same idea rather than that of the Japanese. As the new arrivals bring Marlow up to speed on world events, much of their discussion is framed in terms of conflicts.
Hold the phone here, Churchill. Russia was our ally. Now you're saying we're at war with them?
Like Apocalypse Now, Skull Island exists in the context of a generation that has come of age with the idea of a vaguely defined, ideological, abstract, and all-consuming perpetual war. For Apocalypse Now, it was the Cold War. But for Skull Island, it is perhaps the War on Terror. Skull Island is a delightfully and unapologetically pulpy monster movie treat, but it also understands the genre, its history, and its themes. Skull Island wrestles with the real nightmare of war, the fear that war never ends because it rages like a true monster in the hearts of man. I've been Darren Mooney, and this was In the Fray.